Dan Kittredge did not give me permission to introduce him.
But you didn't ask.
Well, yeah, that too. But I've known Dan for, you know, I don't know, 10, 12 years? 10 years?
I think it was 2003.
2003, yeah. We worked on a political campaign together, progressive candidate for president.
Yes.
And so we've gone from futility to utility. Dan has been a farmer since before he was born. And whereas Ethan says how difficult it is, Dan will tell you how easy it is, but maybe not in this current talk. He will, because he's talking about nutrition and health. But he has a magic touch. He makes a good living at it, and he loves to tell people about how it works.
Thank you, Adam, for putting this all together and your amazing crew here. So I like to think of myself as a farmer, but I like to think that it's so easy I can do it part-time. And so I do. And I run a nonprofit on the side. It's called the Bionutrient Food Association. And our objective is increasing quality in the food supply. We like to think that there's a really nice nexus point there between food quality and systemic shift on a number of measures. So I just want to give a quick background. And Ethan covered a bunch of the basics already, but there's a few points I would like to just delve into a little more deeply before we talk about human nutrition and some of its corollaries, or how to work with it. Just from a basic standpoint, Ethan talked about photosynthesis and sugar. People know this basic equation in a plant. In the green leaf, in the chloroplast, you have carbon dioxide plus water plus sunlight equals sugar plus oxygen. I think most people learned that in eighth grade or ninth grade science class or somewhere around there. And this is really, from my understanding, the key act at the center of this whole conversation. It's that taking of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and turning it into sugar. And then the question is really, how much does a plant do that, and then what does it do with that sugar it makes? And the science I've looked at says somewhere between 50% and 75%, I like to say about 2/3 of the sugar that a healthy plant makes, and this is a healthy plant, it's a key point there, is injected into the soil. And we call these compounds plant root exudates. That plant will take the sugar it manufactures, add certain amino acids to it that are functionally food for different species of bacteria or fungi, and take that sugar, manufacture it, add the amino acids, inject it into the soil, and is then used by those species of bacteria and fungi as a foodstuff with which they can reproduce and go about their business. And this is the important piece, is that different species of bacteria and fungi, there's millions, we don't really know, 4.5 million, we're maybe ballparking, guessing the number of species in the soil. I think the most recent figures are something about 5% of them have been named. So 95% of the species of life in the soil, we don't even have names for yet, much less understand thoroughly, but based on the number of families and genuses, et cetera, we can predict it's in that ballpark. And each of these different species have different functional capacities. Some can solubilize phosphorus, some can solubilize potassium, some can solubilize cobalt or molybdenum. And a plant, to function well like any other living organism, needs a full suite of nutrients out of which to build its body, to build enzymes, etc. And so when the plant makes a exudate for the bacillus, it injects it into the soil, the bacillus eat it, they reproduce. Say they're good at solubilizing potassium. When they die, that potassium is then in that organic construct instead of a crystalline mineral construct, and then the plant takes it and uses it to build its body with. And this is a beautiful virtuous circle, and what happens is that the healthier the plant is, the more sugar it manufactures, the more sugar it injects into the soil, the more food it functionally gets from the soil, and the more it grows and the more productive it is. It's a beautiful, beautiful system, but requires critically this functionality of life in the soil. And so I like to talk about agriculture. Everyone's got their own little name. I like to call it biological agriculture. It's really about the life, the living, the level of life in the soil correlates to the level of functionality in the overall system. And from my understanding, there's a few things that life needs to function, really, really basic things. This life in the soil needs air to breathe, oxygen. Most of these people that work with the plants, I like to call them people, these symbiotes are aerobic, and they need air to breathe. And so when you don't have you a compacted soil, there's no air, they can't function, system breakdown. This is why the aeration, the key line systems, et cetera, are so important. Life needs water to drink. And so again, you know, why we need some of these perennial, you know, water management systems. If you don't have water in your soil, the soil life basically dies. The plant stops being fed. The plant doesn't function well anymore. This is, you get systemic breakdown. You need carbon for that soil life to eat and live in. You need minerals for the soil life to actually be digesting and feeding up to the plant and to exist. And then you need the species of life themselves, which is where the compost tea comes in. So any good agricultural ecosystem must have these critical ingredients in it for it to flourish. And so I just want to make a couple of points about the minerals, because people oftentimes accuse me of being involved in talking about minerals too much. So I just want to use an element, cobalt, as an example, just as a sort of an example. I use it regularly. People may have heard of this compound called B12. Vegetarians are oftentimes told that they don't have enough B12 in their plant-based diet and therefore need to supplement, otherwise they'll become anemic. If they really don't have enough B12, then they become dead, which means that we are B12 dependent. And B12 in science is called cyanocobalamin, which is a fancy name for this compound, which basically has cobalt at the center of it. So it's a cobalt-based compound with a few, you know, amino acids and things attached to it. But if you don't have the cobalt in the environment, then you don't have you can't have the B12, right? Everybody understands this. And so what I like to say is, if you are, an interesting fact is that of all the species of life in the soil that we have studied thus far, about 80% of them are B12 dependent. Simply put, 3.5 million species can't exist in your soil if you don't have cobalt. They require it, as do we. So we have all these critical environmental conditions that must be present for a crop to flourish. And this is where it comes back to my farming background. I grew up on an organic farm here in Massachusetts, in Central Mass. And it was the kind of farm where you do a lot of work and have a good heavy amount of diseases and pests. I'm not sure anybody has tried that or has experienced, whether in small or large operations. But, you know, organic farmers are generally considered to be better people because they have more travails with diseases. Anybody heard of that one? Yeah. That's like being sick is a good sign. That doesn't make any sense. When I got married and I realized that I had no other viable skill sets besides farming, I realized, and I don't like to work all the time, that I needed to figure out this one. You know, there's this really amazing reality where when an organism is healthy, it is resistant to pestilence and disease. If I like to say, if I was here giving this lecture and I was, you know, we were in this room, maybe it was a bit smaller and we were going all day long and I had a cough and I was sniffling a cold, most everyone here would probably end up breathing in my germs, and not everyone here would go home and get sick. And there's a direct correlation between the health and the vigor of your immune system and the susceptibility to disease. And this is exactly the same in plants as it is in animals. These plants have functional immune systems. They're able to build compounds which give them resistance to insects and diseases. And so this is what led me on my path of understanding and becoming, I like to call myself, a lazy farmer. When you actually can grow plants that are healthy, they functionally are resistant to insects and diseases, and not only that, but they have greater yields of better nutritive value, which is the crux point for me. So you take your sugars that are manufactured in the leaf, you inject them into the soil, the plant is able then to take up from the soil life all these various different compounds and elements. So you take your basic sugars and you add the stuff from the soil, because in nature, right, there's nobody adding fertilizer. Everybody remembers that? Right? There's no nitrogen fertilizer added to the forest, and yet the forest grows just fine. That's because two-thirds of the atmosphere is nitrogen, and every single plant in nature has the functional capacity to fix nitrogen from the atmosphere in symbiosis with bacteria and fungi. So when the plant is getting what it needs from its symbiotic relationships with bacteria and fungi, it's able to build from simple sugars, complete carbohydrates, and then from complete carbohydrates, it goes on to build proteins, and then from proteins, it goes on to build lipids and the fats and oils, and from there, it goes on to build what we call secondary metabolites, phytonutrients, antioxidants, things which make a plant have a crop have a smell or a flavor. And it's those compounds, actually, which give the plant also functional resistance. Because they're so large, they are indigestible to insects and bacterium and fungi. So by building these higher-order compounds, your plant functionally, physiologically becomes resistant to infestation and disease. So you've got a really significant benefit there from working in harmony with life. The corollary, of course, for humans is that we have, similar to the soil life in the need for cobalt, we have a need for, my understanding is, a total of 56 different elements for our physiology to function well. Just a quick side note here. How much time do I have left? I don't want to...
9 minutes.
Oh, wow. Wonderful. All right. Just getting started. Maybe some people in this room were involved in this project. They call the Human Genome Project. Back in the 90s, they're mapping human DNA. I'm not sure if anybody here was involved in that. They were, identifying, trying to map the human DNA. And my understanding of the process was that as part of the process, they identified all of the enzymes used to put the pieces of DNA together. And people who don't know what enzymes are, I like to think of them as, sockets and wrenches and screwdrivers. Functionally, they are the things that are used by life to put compounds together and break compounds apart. So to build proteins out of amino acids requires enzymes. To digest proteins into amino acids requires enzymes. They have a specific shape and a specific size based on their chemical constituency. And in the process of replicating a strand of human DNA, it was identified that there are 56 different elements required at the core of the enzymes necessary to replicate human DNA. So to put that big long thing together needs a bunch of different screws and sockets, and they all have different sizes, and if you take them all apart, you can see a total of 56 different elements required. And conventional agronomy recommends generally a total of 3. Right? Nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus. Sometimes calcium is added to raise the pH or sulfur to lower the pH. But functionally, our agronomy does not understand the critical role of nutrition as the objective of agriculture. It's basically the objective of agriculture is to produce volume, to produce quantity, but not to produce quality. For me, there's a really nice little nexus point here when we talk about well-functioning biological systems that, as part of their system function, are sequestering carbon, dropping carbon into stable forms into the soil, and producing high-quality food. So, for me, as with Adam, being concerned, aware, trying to do what I could about the global warming issue for a long time and not finding that it was high enough on most people's priority list, I have shifted my attention to food and food quality, because I think there's a really nice set of degenerative diseases that are becoming epidemic at this point. And with most of our pharmaceutical tools that are being devised to manage disease, none of them are being functionally curing disease. It seems to me, and my understanding is, that when you are unable to put those pieces of DNA together functionally, when you have the chromium-based enzyme missing, what happens is that piece of DNA does not get put together, and you've got these hanging pieces. My understanding is that is called a genetic marker. And we can identify specific mineral deficiencies and their corollary genetic markers, which are your pre-disease states for different degenerative diseases. I'm not sure if people have heard about this, but again, my understanding is that we get a new body on average about every 6 months. People know that one? Your bones take a little bit longer to replace themselves, about 7 years, but your blood, you know, just a few weeks. On average, your body is disassembling and reassembling about 4 billion cells every day. And so depending on what the ingredients are in your food, your body is, when it's replicating itself, is either making poorer or better copies. And so this is, you know, incumbent, this is a direct component of the aging process, is basically physiological breakdown due to a lack of necessary ingredients. All right, so what we do at the BFA is taking all this information, and which, you know, at some point may be inspiring to some people here, and say, okay, from a pragmatic standpoint, what do we do with this? The first thing we do is we educate farmers and growers in the principles of biological systems. You need to have these critical ingredients present in the environment. You need to understand that it's a living ecosystem. You need to learn how to manage and work with your plants throughout their life cycles. And functionally, if you do so, you'll find increases in yield, increases in quality, and profitability. And then we also work with consumers to educate them about the correlation between food quality and degenerative disease, whether it's anybody in their own selves or people in their family. Health is a really a visceral, personal driver, I find, much more so than carbon and global warming. It's that sort of, I think it's Maslow's priority of needs, where only the people who are comfortable are able to focus on the greater issues and the greater struggles. And so my personal suggestion here is that we focus on food and working with quality in food as an economic driver in this whole movement process. So I'll just finish on that one point. And I'm not sure, people here may have heard of this technique called near-infrared spectroscopy, or spectroscopy in general. But in physics, we have a recognition that all elements have a frequency. They vibrate at a specific frequency. There's a star called Alpha Centauri, which is a few light years away. The closest star to us is not the Sun, and we know exactly what that star is made out of. And that's not because we ever went there, but because we can read the light coming at us from it and see that it contains 52% hydrogen and 47% helium and 1% other gases. Whatever it is, we can read that based on the spectral signature. And so all things that appear to be physical actually have a resonant frequency. They're propagating out a resonant frequency, and we can read what they are with a flash of light. And so near infrared spectroscopy is a technology that's about 40 years old and has in the past few years been miniaturized down to the size of a smartphone. And so we can functionally read what's in something with a flash of light and a little gizmo. So that's one project we're working on at the BFA, is the science to define what is a high quality carrot, what is a low quality carrot, what is a high quality side of beef, what is a low quality side of beef, and give the consumer the ability to read that at point of sale before purchase. So you can go to the grocery store and go, beep, beep, crap, beep, beep, crap, beep, beep, decent, and pick the decent bag of carrots off the shelf. I had a conversation with a regional buyer for the North Atlantic region of Whole Foods based in Cambridge a couple of years ago about this technology. And he said, when you guys are a couple of years out from having this, please tell us. Because we will tell all of our growers that they have 2 years to meet standard. There's a direct correlation between flavor and nutrient level and shelf life and all these beneficial attributes, but right now there's no economic driver. Right, consumers don't know that there's a spectrum of differentiation in crop quality. They don't understand the connections between crop quality and health, and as pertinent to this conversation, don't understand the connections between crop quality and carbon sequestration. I think I'm run out of time, but there's lots of exciting things to talk about, and I'll stop there. All right.